because here is the key issue for African countries with respect to some of the policies that are developed. And the one that we can easily think about is the subsidy situation that we currently have in Nigeria, which is nothing more than what I would call a tiger waiting to consume the economy completely. When a nation spends about one quarter of its budget for petroleum subsidy, for consumption subsidies, that's a big implication. And I think these are some of the things that can change the dynamics. If Nigerian government will just wake up today and behave like Indonesia, take away oil and gas subsidy, that probably will have a lot of implication on the global petroleum pricing dynamics. Another issue is the refinery. If Nigeria should wake up today and then build a lot of refineries and be able to capture the regional market with their finished product, that also will have some great implication. Let me conclude by saying that the evidence still suggests that Africa remains a viable destination to search for the black gold. Its sustainability with respect to influencing the dynamics in the oil market is probably not conjectural. I mean, everybody is waiting for that potential that is so can be easily perceived that one day Africa is going to rise and take their right places. The four active members of OPEC have significant influence, and perhaps not because of the level of reserve that they have, but they are endowed with creating a sort of stability. Because if the four of them should pull out of OPEC, that probably will have some legitimacy problem for OPEC. So, and OPEC has always been very willing to be able to bend back or to be able to influence them. Oh, certainly, if you look at the case now in Nigeria, what I think is probably going to be something to watch, which I think the only energy experts should watch, is the incoming administration. And I'm not an advocate of him, neither am I an apologist of him. Actually, what I said is that I think if he comes and then is able to, in my opinion, take the arms by the bull or take the bulls by the arm and remove subsidies, invest in building refinery, that will have big impact on the global oil and gas dynamics. And I have faith that it's probably going to do something traumatic, which I think the world should be waiting for. The key is the domestic oil and gas policies in Nigeria, and politics in Nigeria also to have great implications. I'm not talking about security of assets in the Gulf of Guinea. Those are very, very important, or even talk in terms of equity and community participation. If all of those are taken into consideration, even as the policy development evolves with this new administration, I think Africa still remains a destination to invest in. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much to the panelists, whom I invite to come here to the table for a more lively discussion and interaction with the public. 20 minutes. Now, I immediately, while you are coming this way, I will immediately pose one of those questions that you were always afraid to ask, and I can ask because I have some distinguished panels about the geopolitics as we have heard. There is an ancient Roman Empire say that says that if you want peace, you have to prepare war. That's what the ancient Romans were saying. So I'm asking, because of the geopolitical twist of our analysis as economists, first of all, I have this uncomfortable question. If you think that there are issues or problems of war for the resources, why am I saying this? Because dollar value that James Witt was telling us for the next generation at the level of 1500, 1600, starting from 80 from now, it's not actually, this is the second question I'm going to stop, it's actually not bothering me or shocking me that much. When I was a young teenager, gasoline in Italy was costing around 80 liras per liter. Now, in equivalent euros, it will cost 1,600 lira per liter. So, we've survived the price inflation. Of course, I'm making a joke because we were suffering inflation for our country. But what I'm trying to say is that We have to add a dimension, Jim, to all your analysis in understanding what is, together with the 8% discount rate for the oil resources for the Middle East, what is the long-term discount rate for productivity growth of the Western world, to see if the Western world can sustain technological development and breakthrough that price in, according to the welfare objectives of the year 2050. If that equation matches, then our nephews will be pretty willing to pay a barrel of oil $1,600, because their productivity and their income level per capita will probably be 200,000 in those years' terms. Okay, so that's the part of the equation I would like to ask you. And for that, two gentlemen, there is the nasty question about if there are issues of war. Please. And then the public.
Yes, the public. Do
Yes, thank you, Andrea. Regarding the question of the productivity growth, economic growth, the way that interacts with the oil price, to the extent that's influenced by OPEC, the modeling work I showed you took account of that, so that the higher oil prices reduced the rate of economic growth in all of the developed regions. Of course, it was calibrated to numbers that are highly uncertain in terms of what is the long-term impact of higher and lower prices. But clearly that has to be taken into account. The idea of to make peace prepare for war brings to mind something that none of us did talk about. When I think about the competition to serve the market in the Middle East, and we know there's been competition between Iraq and Iran in the past, we know that Iraq had grand ambitions and still does to increase their export capability dramatically, and we know that OPEC has not yet adopted a policy that would somehow accommodate that. I think if I were in Iran, I would be rather nervous about that. And it may be that there is a strategic, I don't want to say a war mentality, but I doubt that Iran would do anything to accelerate Iraq's entry or expansion in the world oil market.
Well, when you look at not only the earlier pages of history in the Middle East, but also the more recent pages of history, there's certainly truth in the statement that a lot of instability, both internal but also external, is related to oil and gas. Internal, essentially because, well, on the economic side you have the Dutch disease, but more on the political economy, the fact that the governance of many of the countries of the Middle East have not gone in the right direction has a lot to do with their really inability or the curse of commodities and primarily oil. Essentially, the economies have not been well diversified with a large single revenue stream almost, which the ruling elites have used to retain their political power and to, in a way, buy dissent, buy off dissent. No, that's the internal side, which has led to regimes appearing more stable than what they are, actually. So that's also a reason why there's a lot of fear about transition in those countries, because there are no normal, more stable models to ensure political transition in regimes which rest on essentially a single or largely a single stream of revenue. The second aspect is, the more foreign policy aspect, where you certainly have seen in recent years, starting perhaps in the 1990s, with Saddam's occupation of Kuwait, then of course the international reaction, then the U.S. intervention in Iraq, and so on. So there certainly has been a number of episodes that can be linked to the future of oil. There is also, however, the other side of the point where, you know, there we have expected to see some of these oil and gas resources, and here I'm thinking about the Eastern Mediterranean, where the offshore findings could lead to a scenario of peace and settlement in Cyprus primarily, but also in terms of better cooperation between countries like Israel and Lebanon, if they want to leverage some of these offshore resources. Again, this has not happened, but I'm raising this issue because when you're talking, especially on the geopolitical angle, about the potential impact of oil and gas, yes, certainly there is competition for these scarce resources. We've seen the adverse impact of this competition on the stability of the region, but there's also possibility, now I'm saying possibility, that these resources can lead to a more stable, to a more comparative outcomes, and I think that we should not forget.
Thank you.
Well, I think the West African sub-region is, I talk more of the West African sub-region, so because normally in the petroleum classification, the North Africans are usually marked with the Middle East. But I think West Africa, there's less expansion desire from one country to the other. I don't think not many countries willing to invade another country. I think the West African countries are probably gratified that the political situation will not turn sour. So I think what we do, our major concern in the West African Gulf of Guinea is more of political stability than war and disorder. I know there are apprehensions before that in Niger Delta, where the bulk of our oil comes from, could be volatile as a result of the election result. But thus far, it hasn't, I've not seen anything in that regard. And I think the we will expect a positive screen in the next few months with respect to security of assets and the management of minimization of vandalism. A nation cannot go below a particular low level before it rises. And so Nigeria being the bigger player in Africa still has quite a lot of things going for them, more so when we are able to escape all the prediction that 2015 will be the end of Nigeria, which will have consequences on the entire region. So I don't see the issue of war as anything to be afraid of in that particular sub-region when it comes to oil production.
Okay, very good. So questions from the public. There is a microphone, or the first, please, lady. Gentleman here, this is close to you, and then is the president of the Nigerian Association, and then back there. Please.
My question is about Africa. What is your opinion about the political stability of the countries which are in the east part of Africa? Because they are going to start to produce oil and gas in massive quantities. Yesterday we saw a very interesting paper that put into relationship corruption and political stability, and also the natural resources. So what is your vision about how these new findings are going to impact on politically on these countries?
Thank you for the question. That's why they said experiences in life are never lost. I think there are efforts in South Africa, I mean in East Africa, to make sure that lessons are learned from previous oil and gas producers with respect to corruption. And I think CAPSAC is having a series of meetings and dialogues with the research institutes in Uganda, in Mozambique, in Kenya, in Tanzania, to be able to help them fashion a proper policy towards the good use of natural resources. I think one of the biggest challenges is the management of petroleum wealth with respect to political stability. And if you are able to do a fiscal policy that properly targets the use of that resources to build infrastructure, human capacity, and people can see what the oil wealth is being used for, I think some of these dangers that normally come with excessive resources to the politicians could be avoided. And I can say categorically that these countries that you mentioned are doing a lot to make sure that they are better prepared to use their wealth from extractive resources appropriately. And most of the time you see people from Botswana coming to talk to them, Saudi Arabia, from Norway, and they are very receptive because I've had the privilege of participating in three of those meetings.
Okay. Okay.
Please.
Thank you. We're looking at geopolitics of oil and gas. Oil in the context of Africa and the Middle East. But I think there's an emerging problem, especially from the perspective of African oil producers, about I'll call it strategic competition between the Middle East and Africa with respect to sales of crude oil to the East, to Asia and the emerging economies. And if the demand, world demand for oil, you know, is declining, and the growth point is in Asia, and there is competition between African oil and Middle East oil, I think it's important to bring out the issues that may arise as a result of this strategic competition for especially African countries that are emerging to produce oil. Because I know Nigeria is experiencing some challenges in selling its crude oil to the in Asia. The American market has dried, and the European market is not growing. So Middle East is actually directly, Middle East producers, Middle producers are competing with African oil. So what would be the implication of this? Also in the context of climate change, where even the demand for oil in the future may decline? Thank you.
Okay, let's see if Professor Ülgen wants to answer this.
I think it's not just the Middle East. There's also, when you're talking about Asian demand, there are also countries in Central Asia and the Caucasus that are part of that picture. So when you look at the infrastructure projects that China is trying to build, it's also in order to tap the resources in Central Asia. So the situation is actually more complicated than what you have identified. There is certainly an aspect of strategic competition. And there, I think a lot will depend on how these countries start to build up their relationships with the major customer in that region, which is China. We're already seeing the impact of of China becoming a much more significant foreign trade policy player in Africa with investments in primary resources. And with the impact that it has on the governance structures of individual countries. Just a week ago, actually, I was participating, I was speaking to a number of World Bank regional representatives, also working in Africa, and one of the issues was, what does this new competition from China mean for the type of work that the Bretton Woods institutions, that the international financial institutions are doing in those countries? So they were afraid that this China engagement is undercutting their ability to export their norms, their practices, their standards of behavior. So I think fundamentally that will depend very much on what type of relationship can be built with the major customer and the major demand players in that region. And I think we're there just at the beginning of the game, really.
Okay. I have in the book line Professor Hartley and then the gentleman after him, and then the other one down there, please.
Thank you very much. You could have gone before me. But I guess I was wanting to comment a little bit on this affordability question, you know, whether we can afford $1,600 oil. I mean, we tell our students in economics, you know, the demand curve, the critical factor in demand, if you think about it from the point of view of an economist, is not affordability, but what are the substitutes? So, you know, $1,600 oil, there'll be a lot of other ways of getting access to energy to run your vehicles and so forth. Technically, with respect to the problem that Professor Smith's talking about, in addition to the intertemporal arbitrage condition, there's a transversality condition. So at some point, you know, we're going to tie down the price because you go to a backstop. But the thing I think I would like to emphasize on the supply side, I think we learn nothing else from the shale revolution. The incredible thing is that there are a lot of technological opportunities for new technological developments in the supply of oil and gas. And if you have an increase in the price per barrel, it would enable all of these different technologies, so you can recover more of the resource. So there's also sort of a dynamic on the supply side as well as the demand side. And then coming to this issue, if I may, while I've got the microphone, just about the whether shale might be backstop. I think there's another interesting factor in that, in the very short term at least, that we've got this new option that we're seeing exercised in the United States, whereby people will drill the wells, but they won't complete them at a lower price. But then you've got all the drilled wells ready to be completed as soon as the price rises enough to make it worthwhile. So there may be a sort of a different notion of stabilization in the short run, at least, where you could have this sort of inventory of wells that are drilled but not completed, which is different from what we've ever seen before.
James, please.
Yeah, Peter, those are all good points with which I would agree. And just on the last one, my understanding is that this inventory of already drilled wells, the companies stop, they drill the vertical portion, but they do not drill the horizontal. They do not frack the formations, which is still very expensive and not an instantaneous process. It would provide for a faster response, but it's not quite having an inventory that you could tap.
My name is Benny Grigori from Moscow. Yesterday I was speaking on geopolitical gas. But honestly, we are getting tied a little bit of these reserves and costs, because when we go to geopolitics, we have more, we can think of big money. Not earned big money, but used big money. Or the lack of big money. Japan is struggling to hike gas prices. China is trying to hike gas prices against domestic coal. How long Saudis will have this huge money? How Gulf States will have, or Russia will have this huge money? How long United States will be capable to rebuild the chemicals against Europe and so on? So we are working now, and maybe the podium could comment a little bit, but geopolitics is oil money, because it's a lot of oil, physically. It's not a problem. It's competition for certain countries or companies. But how big money are used, which are coming from oil, would it be used for climate change prevention or for political, or it will get into the hands of Islamic State? This is a, for me now, it's much more geopolitical for money than physical extraction, trade, delivery, and competition between companies.
What's your response, please?
Well, I think I'm sympathetic to that view that there's the whole money aspect. It's not just about the physical flow of oil, although the in terms of financing the investments, that's a quite competitive and well-developed industry. And the U.S. side, you know, it's run from New York. And the European side, it all runs through London. But the ability to raise the money, whether it's through private equity or whether it's through bonded indebtedness or bank loans, all of these are well-developed. But I suspect you're thinking more of what happens then to the net proceeds from these big projects. What's next? And that's certainly beyond the realm of implications that I've looked at, and I'm not going to be able to speculate much about that.
Yeah. Was there a hand up down there? No? No more questions? Please, then, Professor Ilan, here, on the first row.
Thank you very much. Ilham of Azizchi University. I thank you, the panel, again, for a very, very nice presentation of this oil outlook in the Middle East and North Africa. My main question will be to the first speaker. Now, you have a very good financial reason for the oil so-called dumping now in the market, because of you explained very well that keeping it underground would be not financially very much viable. Fine, but there is another very important reason. You are talking about 40 years into the future. Nobody knows what will happen to shale oil in 40 years. Maybe the shale revolution will expand all over the world, maybe not in the next 10 years, but in 15, 20, certainly in 40 years. So we may be actually facing an oil glut in 40 years later. And then the price of oil may be just going down because of that, not just a simple balance of a present value of whatever it is in 40 years and versus the present value now, but there would be a glut coming. I'm not saying that it is coming, but maybe one of the actions of the major oil producers now dumping the oil, is that possibility? Thank you very much.
No, it's a great point, although I would object to the use of the word dumping. Dumping typically means selling below cost, and for the Saudis that would be $4 a barrel, perhaps.
We wish,
but doesn't happen. You know, the slides that I showed you were, as I said, prepared in 2006, before there was really a hint of the glut, but there was certainly the possibility of a glut. And you notice the one slide that I showed there said maybe the lesson was learned too late. And what I meant by that is exactly what you're suggesting, that now, you know, the genie can't be put back in the lamp. The oil prices stay too high too long. It's already progressed technology to the point to irreversible directions that could lead to some very surprising, and for some people, very unwelcome long-term developments.
Yes. Ruby wants to make a comment on the competition, please.
Oh, yes, I want to say something about the strategy issue between Middle East and Africa producers with respect to whether to sell the product to Asia or not. I hope, again, hope deferred normally makes the heart weak. But I will begin to think that maybe Africa will need to think in terms of inter-regional trade rather than finding a way to develop their economy. And you and I, you know, have said it over and over again. If you look at West Africa, the population of West Africa is about the population of the United States. The landmark of West Africa is about the same landmark of the United States. So what's wrong with developing the economy in West Africa, that all the oil that are produced in West Africa are available for consumption in West Africa to grow their economy? And if I want to respond to the concern about oil wealth revenue, I agree with you, because some of my position is that when you have that much money and it finds their way into very select people, then it creates problems. Structural problem, governance problem, institutional instability, and so on and so forth. So there must be a better way to manage this petroleum well so that it doesn't produce the type of negative effect that you see around the world when oil is not used properly. So, thank you.
Okay, so it's 3 o'clock. In the interest of the wonderful coffee that is waiting us, let's applaud the panel for the... Thank you for coming.